Please welcome back to the Archangel stage, Seth Godin.
Thank you. Stand up, stand up. Thank you so much. Stand up for your right. Thank you. Get up, stand up. Okay. Hello, dreamers. Thanks for staying all day. I want to talk about changing the world. Before I can do that, I need to talk about trust and dignity and tension. But before that, I need to talk about marketing. And before that, I would need to talk about golf. And fortunately, there's not a lot of golf in Ontario. I hate golf. Golf is a stupid sport. Nothing good ever happens. And if something good does happen, you're not allowed to wildly applaud. You have to do that stupid little golf clap. So if you could get us started, could you just give me the weaseliest, smallest little golf applause you can muster? Yeah, that was terrible. Thank you. Can you double it? Double it again. And one more time. Beautiful. Excellent. So that's how you change the world. Thank you for coming. If my friends in the tech room could switch from this slide to the iMag, I think that would be fantastic. Thank you very much. So that's how you change the world. What do you mean? Well, what we do if we seek to change the world is we find small, little pockets of interest, and we multiply them, and we amplify them back, and then they happen again and again. We are unable to go to somebody who doesn't want to be changed and cause change to happen. Our job is to show up for people who are almost ready to go to the next step. So I'm going to talk for a little bit about why this is so difficult and what we can do about it. To do that, I need to talk about a guy named Willard Bundy. Willard Bundy was a jeweler. 150 years ago, he invented a machine. And the machine he invented was the time clock. And the purpose of the time clock was for every person who didn't own the business to punch in, do their work, and punch out. And what that established is that what we do if we're working is we are selling our time. And it doesn't matter if you're a lawyer or a surgeon or you work at Tim Hortons selling double doubles, you are selling your time. And that means you are a cog in an industrial system. And that industrial system was built to extract as much as it can from you. So a minute ago, we did the golf clap. So while you have your hands out, we're going to turn the lights up just a little so we can do this. While you've got your hands out, here's what I'd like you to do. Take your right hand and raise it as high as you can, please. Great. Now, can you raise it higher? Oh, what's that about? Everybody falls for that every time. And the reason that you held back is because you got taught to hold back from an early age. When you were 3 or 5 or 7, you realized if you gave it everything you had, your parent or your coach or your teacher was just going to ask for a little bit more. And so when you get to work, you hold a little bit back. Because the very nature of industrial capitalism is somebody wants something from you, and your job is to give them just barely enough that you get paid enough to come back tomorrow. But that's it. Because the entire system is built around the idea that you're going to show up and do what you are told, just barely. So now I want to talk a little bit about Ethiopia. Ethiopia is one of the youngest populations in the world. And a significant portion of that population is malnourished, particularly when it comes to protein. As many as 20 to 40% of Ethiopians under 20 years of age do not get enough protein. Well, one reason for this is that the way food is grown in Ethiopia tends to be small land-holding farmers. The farmers aren't small, the land is small, and they own a plot of land. What they grow is what they eat, and if they don't grow it, they don't get to eat it. And the main thing that they're growing when it comes to protein is chickens for eggs. But for whatever reason, and I'm not going to cast aspersions on the actual Ethiopian chicken, but Ethiopian chickens traditionally lay one egg a week. And that makes them a very low-yielding way to produce protein. A guy named David Elias figures out that there is a chicken in France that is much harder working. And he brings some of these hard-working French chickens to Ethiopia. and the Ethiopian government gives him a rundown, derelict chicken hatchery that no one wants. And David, I think, brought more than two chickens with him, but he didn't bring that many chickens, and he starts breeding chickens. And the problem is, once you breed a little baby chick, there's not a lot you can do with it because there's no supply chain, there's no infrastructure. So he starts teaching people to become baby chick entrepreneurs, to take three-day-old chicks and grow them to 40-day chicks that they could then be sold to local farmers. That was a few years ago. Yesterday, Ethio Chicken sold 1 million baby chicks. Tomorrow, they're going to sell 1 million baby chicks. Day after day after day. A chicken that lays eggs 6 days a week, I don't know what it does on the seventh day, 6 days a week instead of once a week. One person showed up and raised his hand all the way up because he could. Not because he invented the chicken, he didn't. Not because someone said, it's your turn to go bring chickens to a place that needs this chicken pioneering concept, right? It's because one person cared enough to show up. 99% of the people who work for Ethio Chicken are from Ethiopia. It's for and by Ethiopians, changing the entire nature of the country because one person showed up and said, here, I made this. And that is precisely the opposite of what you got taught to do. Every person in this room, including me, has been brainwashed to be a sports fan, not a sports player, to be someone who is doing what they are told and consuming as opposed to showing up and saying, here, I made this. So now we get to the soft underbelly of this, the difficult part, which is part of the brainwashing is, will this be on the test? If you ask the question, will this be on the test, it is a symptom that you've been taught to do the minimum to get by and to only pay attention to what you need to pay attention to. And at Akimbo, we're running all of these workshops and things like the Alt MBA, and if that question gets asked, we have a little script that automatically comes back and answers the person about why that question is about education, not about learning. Because learning has nothing to do with the test. When you learn something, you have it forever. No one can take it from you. You didn't get a certificate. You didn't get a piece of paper. You got something forever. So the question is what to learn. Well, if we listen to the people in the educational industrial complex, what we are taught that we need to learn is when was the War of 1812? How many molecules of carbon are there in whatever this, pick something that has carbon in it, quick, this piece of wood, right? That we are taught facts. Why? Because facts are easy to test. Will this be on the test? So now, we're going to turn the lights back on because there's nothing else I want to, something else I want to try. Zig Ziglar was, the late Zig Ziglar was a friend of mine and a teacher of mine, full credit to him for this. Before they invented LinkedIn, before they invented the internet, Zig Ziglar said the following on stage. I want you to imagine there is a giant computer system, and it knows everybody. It knows where they work, what they've done, what they're good at. I mean, he basically described LinkedIn in 1969. And he said, what would happen if you could type into this system, what you were looking for in the ideal employee, or maybe the ideal boss, perhaps even the ideal mate. If you could look, type in what you were looking for, and it could look through every single person and come back to you, what would you ask for? Well, if you ask someone like Warren Buffett, he would say energy, integrity, honesty, hardworking. So someone's going to volunteer, take out a pen. Who's got another one? What would you look for in the perfect employer, the perfect boss, perfect friend? Anybody? Resourceful, curious, coachable, honest, empathic, persistent, integrity. So you could imagine we could come up with 40. And most of us would agree on what all 40 are. We probably wouldn't come up with 400 because we'd have to start splitting hairs, but 40 for sure. And if you could find someone with all 40 of those things, do you think that person would work out? So now here's the question. How many of those 40 things are attitudes, and how many of those 40 things are skills? Now, it gets tricky because we call those skills hard skills. We call those skills things that we can test for. But those attitudes we call soft skills. Maybe we should call them real skills instead. Because here's the interesting thing. The interesting thing is that you are not born knowing how to use Excel or knowing how to juggle. We can agree that these are learned skills that you worked hard at. But you're also not born with integrity, honesty, a sense of humor, or hard work. They're not attitudes, they're skills too. And because they're skills, this is extraordinarily good news because they are learnable. And if we choose to be just a little bit more any of those things tomorrow, we could be. And yet we're still all running around, going $250,000 in debt in the US, running around, trotting out a resume, which is nothing but a list of purported hard skills, and forgetting the fact that what David Elias discovered in Ethiopia is here. I made this. The generous act of showing up for people who need you to show up and taking responsibility for it, that is what is in short supply. You can hire someone to build an Excel spreadsheet for you for $6. That's not scarce anymore. So then we move on to the beginning of this idea of marketing. Because you know what marketing is? Marketing is making change happen. If no change happens, all you've done is wasted money and made a fancy logo. That the reason a marketer shows up is to change somebody from this to that. Now, if you want to do trivial marketing, it's just buy this brand of Kraft dinner instead of this brand of macaroni and cheese. That's probably not worth your time, but you could get a job doing that. Or it could be something really important, like let's figure out how to raise money so kids overseas can go to school. Let's figure out how to change someone from being cruel to being caring. These are marketing acts, because what marketing is the act of changing people. So I learned almost everything I know about almost everything 150 miles from here in Algonquin Park. And to get to Algonquin Park, you have to take the 400, which is fine, to Highway 11, not so much. Highway 11 is just a disastrous strip mall that Canada should be ashamed of. And Canada doesn't have many things to be ashamed of, but Highway 11 is one of them. You're driving down Highway 11, and there's like rundown places that sell muffins and rundown places that sell propane and rundown places that sell fireworks. When I had my slides with me, there was one place that sold fireworks and propane in the same facility. I was only there long enough to take the picture and I drove away. You've seen this place. Now, I'm a vegetarian, so I have to go past Weber's. And once you pass Weber's, there's this place. I got there, it turned out I got there a year after they opened, and all it says is candy shop. Yeah, you've been to candy. Now, here's the thing. You walk in, they've got the weirdest candies from all over the world. They've got toilet-shaped candies. They've got spicy candies. For some reason, they sell pickles. I don't understand that. And it got so popular, people were running across all lanes of Highway 11 on their way home that she had to open an identical one on the southbound side. I'm not sure it's still there, but maybe it is. Still there. So this was my 42nd summer driving up there. So I've been to Rita's a few times. And I got to talking to her, and she told me that the average customer spends $60 per visit, and that this was years ago. She and her husband were making six figures a year in profit running this little place. Now, the extraordinary thing is that you don't need a permit to open a candy shop. In fact, once you have a little building, you call three distributors, you're done. That's it. And yet there's all these rundown muffin places and all these propane places and all these fireworks places, any one of whom could have opened candy shop, and none of whom did. Because they were trying to appeal to the largest possible audience. Because that's part of fitting in. That's what we got taught. Do things for the masses. And Rita and her husband said, what's the smallest viable audience? What's the smallest group of people that we could delight so much that they would go out of their way to come here? And that's frightening. Because if you pick the smallest viable audience, you're on the hook. Because if you can't please those eight people you picked, it's your fault. Whereas if you say, well, it's for most people, you don't know what to do. But if you pick the smallest viable audience, if you put yourself on the hook when you say, here, I made this, then the entire dynamic changes. Sorry, let me take a sip of this. Could you turn the flash off for me? Thank you. So, marketers have this huge power. And the power that we have is the power of being able to show up and tell a story that somehow resonates with people so much that they change. That in the U.S. anyway, when I was growing up, dog food cost about $1 a pound at the most, maybe 50 cents a pound. Now, there is dog food that's selling really well that costs $15 a pound, more than sirloin steak. So we keep spending more and more money, last year in the U.S., billions and billions of dollars on dog food. And as far as I can tell, the dogs aren't any happier. So what is all the money for? What the money is for is to make the dog owners happier. Because the story they got to tell themselves was worth way more than it cost. If any of you have ever done fundraising for a charity, why would anyone donate $50,000 to charity? Only one reason. Because to them, it's worth $75,000. To them, they're getting $75,000 worth of value and pride and community or whatever. And you just sold it to them at the bargain price of $50,000. So we shouldn't hesitate to do fundraising. Fundraising is a gift. Because the only people who show up are the people who want to exchange money for a story. And what we get is the chance, the privilege, the opportunity to start to change the world. So I promised a small riff about dignity. Leona Helmsley was not a good person. Leona Helmsley owned a bunch of hotels in New York. She was known as the Queen of Mean. She was a tax cheat. She ended up getting indicted for tax fraud. After she was indicted, she was sitting there with her lawyer, Alan Dershowitz, I'll just leave it at that, talking about her defense. And while the two of them are sitting there, Leona beckons over her servant. She referred to this elderly man as her servant. And her servant brings two cups of tea. And Leona looks at the saucer of this cup of tea, sees that there are three drops of water in the saucer from when he poured the tea, drops the cup in the saucer on the marble floor, having it break into 500 pieces, and then insists that this man get down on his hands and knees and clean up the broken china. Why did she do that? She did that because she fed on people's lack and loss of dignity. That was her fuel. The thing about dignity is we can give it to other people. It is not easy to take, but it is very easy to give. And when we look at our world today, we are shifting from a world where we had a scarcity of choice, a scarcity of shelf space, a scarcity of items to acquire or people to connect with, to a world of abundance, where there's an unlimited number of people to follow on Twitter, an unlimited number of people who can read the article you write on Medium, an unlimited number of people we can lead and connect and address in our smallest viable audience. That abundance means we no longer have to say to people, well, I can't give you any, because then I won't have it anymore. And instead, we can say to people, if I give it to you, we'll both have it. And so the magic of being a dreamer, of seeking to change the world, is to be able to say, here, I made this, I'm giving you dignity, and now we're both going to benefit from it. A few years ago, I had the absolute delight to spend a day with an organization that has the best name of any organization in the world. It's called Jehudi Kalimo. And Jehudi Kalimo, I just like saying that over and over again. Jehudi Kalimo has a fascinating model. What they do is they will say to a farmer in Kenya, we will loan you enough money to buy a cow. And you can milk that cow and make enough money from the milk to pay off the loan. And within a year, you will own the cow free and clear. The repayment rate on that loan is bigger than the repayment loan rate on a car loan in Toronto. It's 98 to 99%. Why is it so high? It's so high because the only way to get the loan is for your neighbors and the other people in Jehudi Kalimo who are part of the community to recommend you. And so it is the community itself engaging with itself. So the guy who showed me around, he called himself the chairman. And it was an unpaid position, and he was the chairman of the community board. And he was introducing me at each one of the places where they had already set up one of these engagements. And when someone called him, 65-year-old man, Mr. Chairman, you could just see him stand a little bit taller. So the first question is, what did he get paid to do this volunteer work? The answer is nothing. No, it's not nothing. He got paid a lot because he got paid in dignity. He got paid in connection to his community, and he got paid in the hierarchy. Because the thing is, all species, squirrels, elephants, lions, and humans, care a great deal about who eats lunch first. Because if you and your grandchildren and your great-grandchildren always let everyone else eat lunch first, your genes are going to die out. So we evolved to think about the fact that someone's up and someone's down. Who are we next to? What should we wear today? Look around. Is anyone in a tuxedo today? Anyone in a prom dress? How did you know what to wear? Was there a memo? Because you spent some time thinking about what to wear. Because you wanted to fit in just the right amount. Because the hierarchy is an issue. I don't want to look too good. I don't want to look right. Where am I in the hierarchy? And if you are the chairman for Jehudi Kalimo in this town, in this village, you have moved up in terms of status roles. So status roles create the next challenge for the marketer and the next opportunity, which is tension. Because change is always fraught. Change always brings with it the risk of what if this doesn't work? What if I'm wrong? What if they laugh at me? What if they walk away? What if I don't get fed? I better not. I'll hold back. Everyone in this room, I'm going to argue, has a smartphone. Maybe I'm off by 3%. No one in this room bought their first smartphone the day it was introduced. Somewhere between the day it was introduced and today, you felt safe enough to get over the tension of it might not work. And in fact, the tension of I'm being left out was so great, you had to buy one, whether you wanted it or not. Tension causes people to change where they are, what they believe, and what they want. So then the question is, how are we navigating our tension? Some people have defined their place in the hierarchy in whatever field they care about, whether it's shoes or electronics or hairdressing, with, I always go first. I want to be the first person in my town who has pink hair. I want to be the first person who has the latest gadget. I want to be the, you get the idea. These are early adopters. There aren't very many of them. Most of you, when it comes to events like this, are early adopters. You were watching TED Talks before other people knew what they were. Then there's this big hunking middle, the average people. You know what average people want? Less tension. That's why they chose to be average. In other fields, they're not. When it comes to shoes, they're busy buying the latest whatevers instead of those because they like to go first over there. But in this space, whatever this space is, They have chosen to be average. And then the last group of people, the laggards, they're the ones who still have a 12 flashing on their VCR, right? The laggards are so averse to tension, they want to go last. So when you want to change the world, who should you be talking to? Who is your smallest viable audience? Right? If you're launching Napster, don't launch it at a nursing home. That's a bad idea. Now, the thing is, people in nursing homes like music. People in nursing homes have a lot of spare time on their hands. Still, not a good idea to launch Napster at a nursing home. Better to launch it at the University of Waterloo or York or somewhere, because those people also have a lot of time on their hands, also like music, but really like going first because it raises their status to say, I'm listening to a new song before you. So you don't need a lot of people to change the world. You simply need the right people to change the world. Because here's what happens. The only place the average people hear about being left behind, the only way the average people feel the tension is when their friends who are early adopters tell them. Not when the dreamer tells them, not when the advertiser tells them, when they are surrounded by people who tell them. So if I had to summarize all of what I've just told you in 7 words, it's simple. People like us do things like this. People like us do things like this. If you want a visual reminder, a Harley tattoo. Now, the interesting thing is almost no one gets a Suzuki tattoo. Because Suzuki says, we sell motorcycles. Harley says, we are part of the Harley circle, the Harley tribe. That when we look at each other, we see each other as Harley riders, not people who bought a motorcycle. Half of Harley Davidson's revenue comes from things without wheels. Jackets, logos, because it is the uniform you wear to say, I am people like us. Or you go to a walkathon. Walkathons don't raise that much money. But when you're in the walkathon, you look to your left, you look to your right, and you say, whoa, people like us, we're here. And that makes you committed to, I am going to go on this journey. Susan Cain's TED Talk is one of the top 20 along with our friend Liz Gilbert. And Susan Cain's TED Talk is about listening to people who define themselves as shy. How did it become one of the top 20 TED Talks? There are a lot of really good TED Talks. Well, it's simple, because people who define themselves as shy, who felt like they hadn't been being listened to, forwarded it to a lot of people. See? People like us. This is what we're going to do. We need to be together. And so, what we have now is this opportunity to actually do more than just care about something. Here is an interesting statistic. It has a happy ending, but it starts bad. Every year in the United States, until recently, 4 million dogs and cats were killed by the Humane Society and the SPCA and its affiliates. 4 million. Taken off the streets, Canada too. Taken off the streets and killed, because that was their job in their charter. A friend of mine, a guy named Nathan Winograd, went to work at the San Francisco SPCA. He was not in charge. He did not have a budget, and he had no authority. And he saw this going on, and he said, I didn't get into this to kill dogs and cats. So he went to the city council in San Francisco, and humane societies from around the U.S. flew to San Francisco to testify against his plan, saying it was unreasonable, it would falsely raise hopes. He was undeterred. So instead he went to the people of San Francisco, not all of them, just the smallest viable audience, just the ones who were listening, just the ones who cared. And in less than 100 days, Nathan Winograd had raised enough money, but more important, enough volunteers that he created the first no-kill shelter in a North American city. And since that day, not one healthy dog or cat has been killed by the San Francisco SPCA. Because one person said, follow me. Because one person said to a very small audience, let's do this together. Well, you say, well, it's easy. That's San Francisco. Well, he left there and he went to Tompkins County, New York, and he did it again. And then he left there and he went to Raleigh, Durham, North Carolina, and he did it again. And then he went to Reno, Nevada, and he did it again. One person with no authority, who was willing to give dignity, who was willing to create status roles for a hierarchy for volunteers to move up, who told a story as a marketer that people wanted to hear, changed the world. Now, when you hear that story, when you hear the story of David Elias, when you hear the story of Jacqueline Novogratz, who introduced me to Jehudi Kalimo and to Ethio Chicken, one woman with a nonprofit that had four employees changed the way philanthropy is done. Not by doing it all by herself, but by creating an idea that a few people would copy. And then a few more people would copy it without necessarily giving her credit. Fantastic. That's how you know it's working. When people say, of course, and start doing it, what you have done is what you set out to do in the first place. You made change happen. You didn't make change happen because you had some magical hard skill that was some protectable, patentable thing that some venture capitalist says, congratulations, here's some money. You didn't do it because you got picked, because Chris Anderson called you up and said, you need to be on the main stage in Vancouver, and then we're going to make sure directly from us that 100 million people watch your TED Talk. That never happens. What happens instead is we stop saying, I am a dreamer, and we start saying, I am a doer. And what it means to be a doer is that you are looking imposter syndrome in the eye. Now, I have been told by people that they have imposter syndrome, that when they are doing important work, when they are doing work that really matters, they feel like an imposter. And they insist that they have it worse than everyone else and that people of the other gender never have it at all. And I've heard this from every person I have ever spoken to. So I am fairly sure that imposter syndrome is a widespread disease. And people say to me, please reassure me. They don't actually use those exact words. But please reassure me. Tell me I'm not an imposter. Tell me I can handle it. Encourage me. I am here for some motivation. And you know what I say? Damn straight you're an imposter. So am I. How can you not be an imposter? You're predicting a future that doesn't exist yet. You're announcing a project that hasn't been proven yet. Isn't that the definition of being an imposter? You have no proof. On a good day, when I'm working really hard, that is when I feel like an imposter. If you don't feel like an imposter, you're not trying hard enough. You're not being brave enough. So here comes this internet thing. And if you want to, you can look at the internet and say, oh, I'm going to have to go run some short-term funnel ads and run a squeeze play on Facebook to figure out how to make some money doing this, and then before anyone figures it out, switch to make some money doing that. Or you could look at the internet and say, oh my God, everyone's my competition now. My bookstore is in big trouble. Or you could realize that the economy has shifted from one based on industrialism, being a cog, raising your hand just a little bit, to one that's based on connection. We are moving from the scarcity of shelf space to the scarcity of trust. Who exactly trusts you, and who do you trust? And here's what we've discovered in our work to bring the Alt-MBA and other things to the world, which is this. You show up and you show up and you show up and you're persistent and you're generous and you have proof. And you have testimonials, and you have trials, and you're engaging with people, and you have earned awareness, and people trust you. and they still don't raise their hand. They still don't stand up. Why is that? And the answer is because they don't trust themselves. And that is the problem with being a dreamer. So I came here today with my funny, polished, fancy Canadian slide deck, optimized for Canadian audiences, with a whole bunch of new funny things in it. And at the last minute, I realized that it wasn't as trustworthy as coming here and talking to you the way I just have. It wasn't that I didn't trust you to hang with me as I took you through this narrative. It's that I didn't trust myself enough to be able to stand up here and talk to you without the help of my clicker. But then I realized you deserved for me to trust you and for me to trust myself to do that. And so that, thank you, that is part of what it means to do this work. So two stories I want to share with you. My house, I live near Yonkers, New York, and I used to have an office in Boston when I was running my internet company. And if I drove, there'd always be a traffic jam, 4-hour drive, sometimes it'd be 6 hours. And I'd look up and I'd see that flight from White Plains flying effortlessly to Logan, and I'd curse myself for not flying. But other times I would fly and we'd circle the airport and I'd look down and those cars couldn't win no matter what I did. So one time, this is before the TSA, I get to White Plains, 29 minutes later I'm at Logan. Yes! And I have a whole day's worth of meetings, and at 9 o'clock I fly back to White Plains. Karma's a bitch. We circle the White Plains airport in the fog and make an emergency landing in Albany, New York. Now, I've gotten in trouble for mischaracterizing Albany in the past. I don't care. Albany's a pit. I don't want to be in Albany. It's 9:45 at night. The pilot comes on. The pilot says, "We're in Albany." Yeah, I know we're in Albany. We'll be on the ground for 2 more hours. I think I can get you home by 1 a.m. Well, this is ridiculous. I open my laptop. I have this fancy, I'm an early adopter, this fancy modem. I go online. Avis has one car left. They close in 5 minutes. I pay for the car. It's a 4-door car. I close my laptop. I stand up, and I turn to the audience on the plane. Their audience, everyone's an audience to me, to the passengers. And I say, "Ladies and gentlemen, I am not a psychopath. I am wearing a tie." This was back when I was wearing a tie. "I'm wearing a tie. Your car is in White Plains, so is mine. I'm driving home, I already paid for the car. We'll be there in an hour. Who wants a free ride home?" No one raised their hand. As far as I know, they're still in Albany. And I spent the whole ride home thinking, was it my presentation? And then I realized, just as I pulled into the White Plains Airport, no, the problem is simple. If you get off the plane, it's your fault. If you stay on the plane, it's United Airlines' fault. So you better stay on the plane. No! Get off the plane! And the last story, which some of you got from me the other day, is true story. I don't have time to tell you all the detail. But I was at this secret conference in New Mexico. I was with my family. It was really cold out. It was a beautiful night. And they took us out to see Neil Armstrong give his last public appearance. Neil Armstrong came to tell us about what happened 50 years ago this summer, the Apollo 11 mission. There was a little timing involved, I think, because there's a big campfire. And as he's talking, the biggest full moon I've ever seen starts rising over his shoulder. And he stops, and he turns, and he says, "I've been there." The thing is, folks, there are footprints on the moon. NASA, using the sum total computing power of all of NASA, less than the phone in your pocket, sent men to the moon and brought them back 50 years ago. The next time you're having a hard time, the next time you're wondering what people will say about you behind your back, or whether you care enough to lead or to give people dignity, the next time you are frustrated at how hard it is to change everything, just look up and realize that there are footprints on the moon. Because the fact is, as my friend Shalene taught me, every single person in this room has already done something successful. You've gotten paid. That's not the question. The question is, will you choose to matter? Will you do work that matters so much people will miss you if you're gone? Go make a ruckus. Thank you, everybody. I appreciate it. Thank you.